In the late 1960s, Northern Ireland erupted in violence that would claim at least 3,256 lives. This was known as the Troubles, which was fought primarily between the Irish Catholic Republicans, who wanted full independence for all of Ireland, and the British Protestants, known as Loyalists, who wanted Northern Ireland to remain under British rule. The Troubles officially ended with the signing of the Good Friday Agreement in 1998. Unofficially, there is still a good deal of tension between the two sides.
My book Orangutan covers the first 20 years I spent working as a carpenter after I moved here from Tyrone, Northern Ireland. My next book that I just finished is called That's That. It's a memoir of growing up in Northern Ireland, and it's also a document of the Troubles starting from the year 1968 when I was born.
Why don't you tell people what the Troubles are, because some people may not know that.
Well, basically there's been this 400 long feud between England and Ireland, to break it down in its basic terms, and England wound up in control of most of Ireland for a long, long time. In 1916, you had the uprising,
right,
and then in 1920 or 22, whatever it was, you have suddenly Michael Collins signs a treaty, and you have 26 of the counties have been freed. So the northern six counties,
right,
are still under English rule. And then in 1968, basically, the Northern Irish Catholics went to war,
right,
with the English to try and win back the northern six counties.
When we entered Slane, the town was in chaos. Gangs of boys ran screaming through the crowd with their fists in the air. We were knocked and jostled in the fray. I allowed myself to be swept along with them. They were northern lads with thick Belfast accents. Brendan and I linked arms with them and skipped down the middle of the main street, yelling the lyrics of a rebel song we knew well. A nation once again, a nation once again, and Ireland long a province be, a nation once again.
I didn't think about where I grew up in terms of war.
Mm-hmm.
As far as I was concerned, that was just how people lived.
Right.
So as a kid, everything sort of seems normal. A kid in a house that grows up in a house where there's abuse just accepts what is happening as normal. It's not until you have the perspective of being older and looking back that you sort of say, oh, because even when I wrote this book, I had people that I lived with and grew up with would say, nothing really happened where we lived.
Right.
But where we lived was in Tyrone. We lost just as many people almost as Derry and Belfast. It was really, that's where the heart of the war was in the country, was in Tyrone. And it turns out in writing the book that I revealed to myself that I was actually very close to a lot of the action that happened in County Tyrone,
right,
at the time, and didn't realize how close I was to it until, you know, I finally sobered up 6 years ago and,
yeah,
started looking at it with some kind of clear perspective and really trying to educate myself on,
right,
my own history and trying to find out what the Troubles meant for me.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a very confusing situation, even if you've lived there. And part of what I was trying to do in the book was to sort of clarify it,
right,
not just for an Irish reader, but for an American reader,
yeah,
where you could pick it up and finally go, oh, this is what happened.
Right.
Because it's such a cloudy issue. Even now.
But what do you think it meant to be, you know, Catholic? I mean, it's, you know, and being like categorized at that time.
Without question, that has formed. Being Catholic growing up in Northern Ireland meant that you lived with an air of repression at all times.
Right.
And I don't know if that made me more rebellious than I would have been, or if I was born rebellious and that just compounded my rebellious nature. But you have this, just to break it down in basic terms, as a Catholic, it didn't matter if you were just going to drive into the local village for a loaf of bread, you get stopped by a British patrol, and they're no older than you are, they're 18 or 19 years of age, and it's raining, and they make you get out of the car, and they humiliate you, and you see this happening to your father, and to your brothers, and to your uncles, and men, Catholic men, humiliated in front of their wives,
right,
or their children, just going about their daily business. And that sort of just feeds into this sort of feeling of hatred and repression and anger, and that happened on a daily basis,
right,
throughout our whole lives. It was just an accepted part of what we did.
Did that give the church a bigger role in your life?
Without question. Because of where we grew up, being Catholic became a number one element of our identity, even above being Irish.
Right.
We were Catholic. In Northern Ireland, there are two very specific groups. It's not even English and Irish, it's Catholic and Protestant.
Right.
And, you know, it wasn't until I was much older that I was in college here in my 20s that I started asking questions like, what is a Protestant?
Right.
And then realizing, oh my God, a Protestant is actually a Christian too.
Yeah.
And looking into what that meant and realizing that there was a lot of common sense to the Protestant religion also, and realizing that any religion, most of the religions at their essence, are really good.
Yeah.
It's what people do with them. And sort of the distorted nature of how we view religion, sort of, and people make it ugly. But the Christian message is basically the same. In
yeah.
And that sort of was shocking as an adult to realize that we'd grown up hating Protestants,
right,
but having no idea what that meant.
Right.
That it was really just a political thing.
Yeah. And that, as a kid, you were an altar boy as well. Correct.
I was an altar boy,
yeah,
and it was sort of an honor to be an altar boy,
right,
and not just an honor, it was a lot of fun.
Right.
You got to be, it wasn't as boring as
you had a role in the church.
And you got to be up on the altar, and
right,
it was kind of special. And you know, it's funny, we had one particular incident. We would go out and play tag with our friend, with the other three altar boys. We would run out and play tag through the headstones.
Right.
Before Mass start, and one day we're playing tag through the headstones,
mm-hmm,
and we listen, and one of the guys says, oh my God, Mass has started,
right,
and we're still out there, and the priest had just gone and started Mass without us, so we had to come back in through and like file out onto the altar, and there's like 300 people in the church, and I just walk in, and the first face I see is my mother's.
Yeah.
So
she was fairly strict growing up, wasn't
my
she?
Mother was a strict woman, yes she was.
Yeah.
I love her dearly, and
we're
very close. But I was very angry with my mother growing up. As an adult, I can look back and see that she was trying to do the best that she could with what she was given.
Right.
In an area where it was dangerous to let your kids out of your sight.
Right.
Boys got involved in situations where they could wind up getting shot very
right.
easily, and friends of mine did wind up getting shot, very good friends of mine. My mother was, I think, overprotective,
mm-hmm,
but I guess I can't judge on that. She did
You're
what
still
she...
Here.
I'm still here, and I look back at it now and I think, well, maybe I needed to take this particular path in order to be able to survive and write it all down.
Right.
That this was my particular path, whether it's chosen or it's destiny or whatever it is, but I've come to accept that what happened, happened, and that's just the way my life was.
The area that I grew up in, it was impossible as a young Catholic boy not to be affected by the nationalist sort of vibe, the atmosphere. When you have the local priest saying from the altar, it's okay to kill in war, that that's acceptable in the eyes of the church, it sort of opens up a lot of avenues and possibilities and options. And we really, as kids, sort of revered this sort of, like, we knew who was involved, but it was unspoken.
Yeah.
You didn't say to your friend, oh, I know he's involved or he's involved, but the entire community sort of keeps their blinkers on. This doesn't exist within a community without the support of the community, without the silence of the community. So everybody sort of played their role. And then growing up, you realize that these boys who they were sort of heroes to us. Because we were getting abused by young British soldiers on the road, but these boys were actually doing something about it. And as a kid, when you're not sort of, when you're not dealing with fear of mortality, the idea of the hero is an enormous thing. And these older boys, it seems like a very cool thing to do, to go out and perhaps do something for your country. Which is the idea.
Were you actually approached at any time to join, or?
You're never approached.
Nobody
would approach you. You would find yourself in a situation where perhaps you had a lot of friends who were sort of sort of drift towards that circle. And if you were sort of then accepted into that circle, then maybe an opportunity might arise for you to do something, which was starting to happen with me. And then you would sort of, from there on, and be testing the waters and be tested to see how far you would want to go with that. Once I started, you know, losing people that I knew, there was actually a name and a face and a personality attached to the death, and it wasn't just another name that I heard on the news. Well, then that made it really personal. And you could understand and feel like there was justification towards joining the local military to help fight back. And that it had definitely reached that point before I left Northern Ireland.
So what precipitated the move from London into New York?
Well, I was basically bouncing back and forward from London to Northern Ireland for a couple of years and getting more enmeshed in the nationalist situation in my community, getting closer to some guys who were involved, and that sort of back and forward became, I started running into trouble in England with my drinking, and that started becoming a problem. And then I would come home to Northern Ireland and things would get a little hot and heavy there. And it basically culminated in me realizing that I had to make a decision, that I was getting so angry. What happened was Loch Gaul happened, what's known as the Loch Gaul Massacre. And there were 8 young Irish Catholic boys who were in the IRA who were slaughtered that day. And it was a turkey shoot. Basically, the British had the information on these young boys. They knew they were going to attack the police station. They waited until they did that, and the place was surrounded in advance. And then they just wiped them out. And I knew some of those boys, and I was very close with their families and had lived with them in London. And when that happened, I snapped. That was the moment where I thought, I'm going to have to do something now. My mother, I won't get into it, but my mother very deftly and ingeniously stopped me in my tracks. And I realized that what I really needed to do
was get out of Northern Ireland.
Yeah.
And not get involved, which I did, and then I came to New York. And it's funny, you know, I left home. One of my best friends at the time was a guy called Brian Mullen, and I was in. And Brian Mullen was the guy I was like starting to drive for once in a while and do like a favor here and there. And then I was here 3 months, and Brian was assassinated by the SAS with his brother-in-law and his brother-in-law's brother, and all three of them were killed. So I got that phone call 3 months after I arrived.
Yeah.
So.
All right, let's talk a little bit, you know, coming to New York, which is chronicled in Orangutan. It's, you know, it's a pretty amazing book. I mean, there's been a lot of books about drinking and trying to become a writer, but I guess part of what I liked about it, there was no, like, self-pity and no blaming it. It was very matter-of-fact, this is what happened. You know, you disappoint a lot of people. I think you disappointed yourself, but you didn't make excuses.
Right.
Is that something that you kind of consciously decided to do going in?
Very much so. And my editor at Random House applauded me on not hanging anybody but myself.
Yeah.
And that was my goal, because I wanted to sort of just say, this is what it looks like to be a drunk, which is what I was.
Yeah.
And I sort of had reached a point in my life where in 2006 had wound up basically having to be taken from my apartment to dry out upstate, and wound up going to jail for a couple of months, and things had reached the bottom. And I saved myself by writing. I sat down and just started writing my story, and realized that I really needed to get to the bottom of what it was that I was doing in order to save myself, which is how the book was written. I had to dry out. I took the 4 train back to the Bronx and went up to my little attic room with a bottle of water and lay down on the bed and settled in for the long ride back to sanity. The scary thing about drinking alcoholically for years is that you become aware of how your body will react to detoxification. You recognize the symptoms as they are happening, and they're as familiar to you as a cold. I was 19 years old and living in London for the first time. I went through the delirium tremens when I started to hallucinate that a little girl was standing at the bottom of my bed staring at me. I didn't know what was happening, and it scared me half to death. But as the years go on, you become accustomed to this kind of horror. You understand that for every day spent on the run, the price will be a little higher. The nightmare of detoxification will have intensified just a little more. It is simple mathematical logic. What goes up must come down. And the higher you go, the longer and more terrifying the fall. It is this gripping fear of this inevitable nightmare that keeps the alcoholic drinking after a while. Jumping through the porthole back to sobriety means a temporary loss of sanity, and no matter how many times you've gone down that path, it never gets any easier. After a while, the alcoholic drinks to maintain sanity. There is no enjoyment in the booze at the end of a run. Each drink is a battle, a temporary relief from madness. The alcoholic knows that when he can find the strength or motivation to put down the last one, he is in for hell. There is no escape. I envied the Americans who I met who were always off to rehab for the comfy come down. For most drunks, rehab is a luxury we will never know. $3,000 or $30,000 or whatever a week or two in a clinic costs these days can buy an awful lot of booze or pay off an awful lot of debt. Most of the drunks I've met don't stop the run until every last penny is consumed, every bridge burned. We lay in our attic rooms. We slip the devil's noose around our necks, and we fall back into the nightmare of reality. That is how it feels coming off a drunk.
Did God or religion have any help in getting you sober?
Well, God and religion has been basically, you know, apart from, you know, being Irish, that has been the driving force through a lot of my own life. I was raised Catholic. I think that I went away from the church for so long and was angry with the church and felt angry that sort of blamed the church for feelings of guilt and shame and feeling less than. And then, you know, as I've gotten better, come back to realizing that there's so much goodness in Christianity, and that I still can see now sort of the universal good in people. And I think a lot of it has to do with where how healthy I am.
Right.
And when I'm healthier, I can see the goodness in Catholicism, mm-hmm. specifically, right. if that's what you're asking about. But I can also see it in Buddhism. I can right. see it in Protestantism. There's, and I think the basic message, when it's all boiled down, when you take like the Quran and the Bible and all these other texts, is just try to be a nice guy.
Right.
Try to treat your fellow man with some level of decency.
Yeah.
Try to treat other people as you would like to be treated yourself. Mm. And that's basically the whole deal.
Right.
That's the whole message. It gets polluted
right.
by politics and money and all this other stuff. But basically the message is just try to be a nice guy.
Yeah.
If you could do that. It's funny, I wrote this play coming out of my second marriage, mm-hmm. and I didn't realize until I wrote it 13 years ago,
right.
14 years ago, and I didn't realize until we were in rehearsals to do it this time, how biographical
right.
the actual play was, and it really does deal with the end of that marriage, and it deals with this situation that was going on. My wife wanted to have a baby,
right.
and for some reason she couldn't, and we were going through all these specialists, and that's a very difficult, and I know a lot of other people now who have done that, and that's a
right.
horrible sort of strain to put on a marriage.
Right.
And I guess I wasn't ready. It's like the Martin character in the play says at the end,
yeah.
I just wasn't ready. And I guess I just wasn't ready.
Right.
But I do have now, I stopped drinking 6 years ago, and I have a daughter now who's 5 years old. She's
right.
five and a half, and it has changed my entire perception of what love is.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure if I understood ever what love was until I had a child of my own, and now I understand what sort of non-judgmental
mm-hmm.
love is, because I just love my daughter.
Right.
Every day, it doesn't matter what she does, I just love my daughter. And you realize, oh, this is not going away.
Right.
I just love my daughter. And that's sort of, it's an amazing education, because you realize sort of what your own capacity for love is suddenly.
Right.
And that is, it's amazing, because you realize that here's a part of myself that I've never tapped into before.
Right.
In any relationship,
mm-hmm.
is sort of an all-forgiving love. It doesn't matter what she does, she's still amazing.
Great.
It's amazing.
All right, what about future plans? What do you got planned for the future?
This is Kevin McCann, the producer for the movie The Rising, based on Sean McDermott and his particular role as mastermind in...
1916.
In the 1916 Rising,
yeah.
right? You want to say something about what the movie is?
Sure. Well, it's the first film on the rebellion of 1916, the rebellion to free Ireland from imperial rule, and I am working at the moment with Colin, and very pleased to do so. We are looking forward to a production in 2015 and a release of the film in 2016.
We do have a social media platform that we're trying to raise awareness for the movie. We have a Facebook page. We're on Twitter at 1916 Movie or 1916 Rising?
At 1916 Film.
1916 Film on Twitter. And we have...
Two syllables, film.
And we have the website, therising.ie. And we have the Facebook page. So if anybody wants to follow, obviously they can look us up.
Sure, and at the moment we're at the stage where we have some finance, a good deal of finance in place, but we're still looking for investments. And if anybody is interested in taking part in what's expected to be an extremely significant Irish film, we'd very much like to hear from them.
Well, I'm going to, say goodbye, and we'll see the play tonight, but it was great talking to you.
Wonderful. Very nice talking to you too, Terence. Thank you
very
much.
Good.
Wonderful.
Okay.
Awesome.
All right.
Yeah. This is Eamon Lumsey. He's actually an author of 3 different books.